over to you.
Thank you, sir, for your kind words. And first of all, I would like to thank the organizers, especially Dr. Verma, Dr. Rashi, and Dr. Anju for inviting me to give this presentation. And we are all passionate learners. We are all devoting our precious weekend morning time to this learning process. So I wish our all the best to us all. So why we should talk on imaging? Being a radiation oncologist, what is the relevance of imaging? We need to understand imaging for accurate target identification, which is a very important component of radiation therapy to the liver, besides the motion estimation and immobilization. We need this for adequate tumor coverage while sparing a normal hepatic parenchyma. So in the coming about half an hour, I'm going to talk about mainly hepatocellular carcinoma because that's the most common liver tumor. What are the imaging modalities to be used? Brief about pathophysiology and introduction of LIRADS. We will talk about imaging features of different kind of HCCs, the mass forming common HCC or a diffuse infiltrative pattern or tumor in vein. We will briefly touch upon other non-HCC liver tumors, especially the intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma and metastasis. And at the end, we will discuss about the treatment options and relevant imaging. So first of all, which imaging modality to choose when? Now, CT is a very nice imaging modality. It gives very crisp images. And usually the technical requirements are not so hard. MD-CT, more than 8 detector row, is acceptable for doing a good dynamic post-contrast imaging. However, the limitation is that the images given by CT are usually only post-contrast images. FDG PET over CT is not very helpful for HCCs. However, it is helpful for cholangiocarcinoma and metastasis. In HCCs, we know that maybe up to half of HCCs may not show adequate FDG uptake. And if there is an aggressive HCC, it may show FDG uptake, but a low-grade kind of HCC will not show FDG uptake. So, not a very good modality for HCC per se. Now, MR is actually the undoubtedly the best imaging modality for liver tumors, whether it is 1.5 or 3 Tesla MR, both are good enough. The advantage of MR is that we get other sequences as well, including T2, T1, and diffusion sequences. And these sequences give very high soft tissue contrast resolution and give a wealth of information. We'll just see how. Post-contrast dynamic images can also be repeated in more number of phases because there is no radiation with MR, and every single post-contrast dynamic image takes about 10 to 12 seconds to acquire. So instead of 3 sets of images at CT in MR, we can get 5, 7, 10 set of images according to our protocol. And also if we are giving a hepatobiliary phase contrast, then we have the advantage of obtaining a delayed hepatobiliary phase image by MR. We'll just see how it is useful. So overall, there is a multi-parametric evaluation by MRI in liver tumor imaging. So today we are mainly going to focus on MR. I'm sure we are all very well versed with seeing the CT images, but MR images are slightly tricky and we need to learn them over the time. So first of all, the localizer images are taken to plan the scan. They are taken in all the 3 planes. Now there's a big difference between CT and MR in that MR images are good in the plane in which they are acquired. While CT images are always acquired in axial plane and then they are very nicely seen on coronal and SAG. But in MR, we need to acquire images in that particular plane to see them nicely. Now, T2 weighted images are actually the most useful images in abdominal MR. On T2 weighted images, we are all familiar that fluid is bright and the fat is also bright. And most of the lesions contain relatively higher amount of fluid. So most of the pathologies are bright, whether it is cyst or abscess or tumor, they are all edematous tissue. So, and the liver is relatively darker than spleen. So liver parenchyma is not very bright. So against this darker liver parenchyma, the abnormalities stand out very nicely, even on plain T2 weighted images. For seeing a small amount of fluid against a fatty background, like peritoneal fluid, we need to do fat suppression. So T2 can be done without fat suppression or with fat suppression. And this sequence has to be repeated in coronal plane as well. These T2 images which we acquire are 2D images. So it is difficult to use them for radiation planning, but they are very good for identification of tumor. Now the next important images are T1 in and opposed phase images. This is a very useful sequence. A single sequence takes about 10 to 15 seconds. And it single sequence gives 2 set of images. This is the out phase set and this is the in phase set. So in the out phase, we can identify the image by the India ink effect on the surface of organs. In the out phase, the fat and water signals cancel each other. So whenever there is an intracellular fat, there is a signal drop. And the same is not true for pure fat. Pure fat is still bright on out phase, but the intracellular fat, which is mixed with water, shows signal drop. So whenever there is a hepatic steatosis, there is signal drop on a post phase compared to in phase. And this steatosis can be quantified pretty accurately on these in and a post phase images. Also, if there are multiple steatotic nodules in the liver because of regenerative dysplastic nodules or tumoral nodules, they can be seen very well. Sometimes the liver mass itself contains large amount of fat, which can be detected on this in and a post-phase images. Diffusion images are a big tool in the MR armamentarium. It is a non-contrast image, but it gives a PET kind of image. The outline, the background is blurred, but the abnormalities stand out. So on diffusion images, we can very well see small deposits in the liver. In fact, this is the most sensitive sequence to pick up tiny liver metastasis. Also, we can see the surface deposits. We can identify the lymph nodes very nicely, and then we can go back to T2 or the post-contrast images to again assess these nodes. So diffusion images are a very big tool in the MR. MRCP can be added as and when required, especially in the cases of cholangiocarcinoma or tumors causing biliary obstruction. They can be done in a 2D mode with a single shot breath hold MRCP or a 3D navigator based technique in which the entire slab of the tissue is imaged. And these are 3D images can be reconstructed in other planes as well. Now, these are the favorite sequences of radiation oncologists, the post contrast images. Post contrast images are acquired in different phases. In MR, we have the luxury of acquiring them in two arterial phases, the early arterial for vascular anatomy and the late arterial for actual tumoral enhancement. Then subsequently, we see the portal phase and multiple hepatic venous phases. Now, if we have given the hepatobiliary contrast, we can obtain a hepatobiliary phase, which is a delayed phase. The commonly used contrast in our setup is multi-hens, the gadolinium bopta. And with this contrast, the hepatobiliary phase comes after 1 to 2 hours of injecting contrast. So in this phase, the entire liver parenchyma shows good amount of enhancement because the hepatocytes have taken this contrast. And it is also excreted into the biliary system. So it gives a positive cholangiogram kind of image. And all the lesions which do not contain hepatocytes appear dark in this phase. So it is very sensitive to detect tiny metastasis and for lesions which do not contain active hepatocytes. So just a small word on hepatobiliary contrast. There are two contrasts available, multi-hens and Primovist. However, Primovist is not available in India. The advantage of Primovist is that it has a huge amount of hepatobiliary excretion. 50% of the amount of contrast is excreted through the biliary system. So the cholangiogram kind of effect and the hepatocyte phase is much more pronounced with Primovist compared to multi-hens. However, there is a trade-off. The vascular enhancement is lower and shorter with Primovist. Also, it is very expensive. Another advantage with Primovist is that the hepatobiliary phase is quite early. It is only 20 minutes after administration. So entire scan can be completed in one go. While using multi-hens, we have to shift out the patient and taking another patient in between because it takes 1 to 2 hours after administration of contrast. So after this brief introduction of MR protocol, let us talk about pathophysiology. Why we need to understand pathophysiology? Because the imaging also mirrors this pathophysiology. Now, with our concept of cirrhotic liver nodules, we know that the transition of cirrhotic liver nodules is a continuum of process. It's not discrete steps. So once the regenerative nodule is formed, it increases in cellularity, a dysplastic focus is formed, which derives its supply from the hepatic artery branch. Gradually, the hepatic arterial branches increase, and then it forms a HCC. So during this journey, the portal supply decreases. Normally, the majority of liver, 2/3 of the blood supply to liver comes from portal vein and 1/3 through artery. But once the cirrhotic nodule de-differentiates, the portal supply decreases and the arterial supply increases. And this is because of this that we see hyper-enhancement of nodule in the portal phase and hyper-enhancement in the arterial phase. And during this journey, there may be an intermediate stage at which there is a loss of portal supply with development of insufficient number of non-triadal arteries. So if we image the nodule at this particular phase, it will appear hypovascular, and usually this phase corresponds to a dysplastic nodule or early HCC. So as we know that about 1/3 of HCCs may not show arterial phase enhancement, so basically they correspond to this stage. Now, as we discussed that there is a continuum of changes, so it is sometimes difficult to give a proper label to a cirrhotic nodule, because of which the report may be very bizarre, haphazard, and the physician is not very happy to see these kind of reports. So to circumvent this problem, the American College of Radiology, they devised a liver imaging reporting and data system, popularly known as LIRADS. The concept was initiated in 2006, but it came out into practice in 2010, and then every third year there is a new update. To begin with, it started with CT and MR algorithm performed with extracellular contrast in cirrhotic patients who are at risk of HCC. But gradually over the years, it has included ultrasound, contrast ultrasound, and also the treatment response ladders. So this is the link. Anybody who is interested in liver tumor imaging must visit this link. This is a free literature on Google, and this is very, very informative. All the questions are answered with this link. So the LIRADS committee has devised few major features and few ancillary features of HCC. The major features include mass-like configuration, the size of lesion is important, arterial phase hyperenhancement, which is non-rim-like. Now, this is a very important thing. The enhancement should not be in a rim-like fashion. The washout should not be only a peripheral washout. It should be from the entire tumor or from the center. There may be enhancing capsule. Threshold increase in size is defined as more than 50% increase within less than 6 months. And if tumor is seen within the lumen of a vein, then again, it's a very major feature. There are a few ancillary features, few features favoring malignancy and few favoring HCC in particular. So features favoring malignancy are when the nodule is seen on ultrasound, there is growth, but not to that threshold level. Restricted diffusion, mild to moderate T2 hyperintensity, corona enhancement, fat sparing or iron sparing, which can be seen on in-phase or post-phase images, transitional phase or equilibrium phase hypointensity, and a hepatobiliary phase hypointensity. There are few features which favor HCC in particular, especially the non-enhancing capsule, nodule and nodule appearance because of the continuum of pathophysiology, which we just discussed, mosaic architecture, blood products in the mass, fat in mass more than the adjacent liver. So whenever we see a liver nodule, we need to categorize. Various categories have been classified by the LIRADS committee. Tumor non-categorizable because of image omission or degradation. Benign tumors fall in LR1 and LR2. Intermediate probability of malignancy falls in LR3. Probably HCC is LR4. Definitely HCC is LR5. Tumors other than HCC are LRM, and tumor in vein is LRTIV. So first of all, when we see an observation or a nodule in the liver, we need to categorize according to these categories. If it is fitted in these categories, LRNC, TIV, LR1, 2 or LRM, then it is well and good. But if it does not fit in these categories, then we have to apply the CTMR diagnostic table. Now we'll not go into detail of this. I just wanted to discuss the concept of LIRADS because it's a very nice and popular concept, and we should all know about it. We should be familiar with this. So grossly, we can notice that as the size of tumor increases, the criteria which are required to call it malignant decrease. The essential criteria is arterial phase enhancement. If it is absent, then we need more ancillary feature, more additional major features to call it malignant. If it is present, then we need lesser additional major features to call it malignant. After we have used this table and assigned a category, the second step is to adjust the category according to the ancillary features if required. So we can always make category adjustment based on the ancillary features. Now we have categorized the tumor and we have given a LIRADS category, and accordingly the management can be suggested to the referring physician. After this, let us discuss what are the specific imaging features of different kind of HCC. First of all, the most commonly found mass-forming HCC. So overall, in a cirrhotic liver background, the regenerative nodules are normally iso2-hyper on T1 and iso2-hypo on T2. So HCC, when developing in these regenerative nodules may also retain that kind of signal. However, when it becomes advanced, it changes signal. So T1 hypo and T2 hyper is also seen in HCC, and when it is seen, it is relatively a higher grade of HCC. Diffusion hyperintensity is again seen in relatively advanced HCC with low ADC signal. Arterial phase enhancement may or may not be present. Usually it is present, but in 30% HCCs, it may not be present. On venous phase, they are hypoenhancing because of loss of water supply. And additionally, presence of tumor fat indicates a relatively low grade and a well-differentiated HCC. And presence of necrosis and hemorrhage indicate a more aggressive HCC. Small HCCs may have a very homogeneous internal architecture, while large HCCs may have a mosaic pattern and a tumor capsule. So let us just look at some examples on the images of few of the liver tumors, few of the HCCs. Now, this is a garden variety of low-grade HCC. We can see very well-defined nodule in the liver, slightly exophytic, arising from segment 5-6 junction. This is hyper-intense on T1. These are the in-phase and post-phase images. We can see the post-phase has this India Ink effect. And in the post-phase, we can see area of subtle signal drop in the center of the lesion. So there is a little amount of intratumoral fat. On T2, this is dark in signal, so preserving the signal of regenerative nodule. However, it is much bigger in size. On contrast enhanced images, we can see that there is an arterial phase enhancement, which is non-rim-like, and there is a washout, which is non-peripheral. And on the delayed phases, there is a capsular enhancement. So this is a classical, relatively low-grade kind of HCC. Another case, a larger tumor, bright on T2. You can identify the T2 with the fluid seen in the images and the fat, which is bright. So bright on T2. Relatively hypo on T1. There's a small area in the tumor which is bright on both T1 and T2. So this bright on both T1 and T2 indicates hemorrhage or proteinaceous content. In this particular case, hemorrhage is more probable using the common sense. So we can see there is no fat. If we compare the in-phase or post-phase, there is no fat in the tumor. There is some fat in the liver parenchyma, and the liver is not cirrhotic. So in a non-cirrhotic liver, HCC is developing, there is some fat, it needs extra mention because there may be NASH. There is strong diffusion hyperintensity. This is the ADC map, which is generated by the diffusion-weighted images only. And this is a quantitative map, and this can be used for quantification of ADC value, especially for research purposes. Now, on the pre-contrast T1, one should again be aware of this T1 hyperintensity, should not confuse it with arterial phase enhancement. On the arterial phase, there is a lot of heterogeneous enhancement, non-rim-like. Subsequently, there is a washout. And then the capsule is very indistinct and thin and irregular in this particular case. So seeing this kind of morphology, we can say that this looks like a more aggressive kind of HCC. This is showing wrong signals on T1 and T2, markedly hyper-intense signal on diffusion, and a lot of arterial phase enhancement. HCC may be solitary or multifocal. Sometimes the entire liver may be studied with HCCs, in which case it may be difficult to differentiate it from liver metastasis. However, there is background cirrhosis, and the AFP value may also help. There is a special category of HCC known as fibrolamellar HCC, which is seen in young patients. And this is not related to cirrhosis. AFP is usually normal. There is a classical appearance, a large mass is seen with peripheral enhancement and a large central stellate scar with radial septum, which may show persistent enhancement. And sometimes calcifications are also seen in these fibrolamellar HCCs. So this particular case, we can see that the liver parenchyma is non-cirrhotic. There is a huge mass in the right lobe of liver with central scar and diffusion hyperintensity with hypointense signal on ADC maps. Arterial phase images show heterogeneous enhancement in the tumor, increasing on this portal phase. There's some washout. The washout is always compared with the background liver parenchyma. There may be, if we compare the ROI, there may be actual increase sometimes, but if the background parenchyma is relatively hypo, is relatively hyper compared to the tumor, then the tumor is said to have a washout. So these were mass-forming HCCs. Now coming to the another category of diffuse infiltrative HCCs. In this particular category, MR is especially more helpful than CT scan. Why? Because the tumor has permeative appearance a lot of time, and there may be minimal or inconsistent arterial phase enhancement. Even the washout may be very heterogeneous during the venous phases. And frequently, there may be portal vein thrombosis in 68 to 100% cases, which may cause perfusional changes. So the classical appearance of arterial phase enhancement and washout on the venous phase may not be seen in the cases of portal vein thrombosis. So the tumor of diffuse infiltrative HCC may be better seen on diffusion T1 and T2 than dynamic post-contrast images. So just to see an example, you can see that this is a post-contrast MR. You can identify with the dark signal on the vertebral bodies. So there's a MR. It is very difficult to see the infiltrative pattern of HCC on post-contrast images. However, on plain T2 and T1 and diffusion images, they are much more conspicuous. Diffuse infiltrative HCC may have associated tumor thrombus, like in this case, it is hypointense on T1, hyper on T2. Basically, it follows the same signal as the primary tumor. If the tumor, and this criteria is very useful in detecting a tumor in vein. If we can see a primary tumor in the same contiguous signal going in the lumen of the vein with distension of vein, we can see arterial phase enhancement of the tumor in vein. There's some washout as well. And there's a heterogeneous pattern of washout in the venous phase. So because of these atypical kind of features, there are various mimics of diffuse HCC. Sometimes focal confluent fibrosis may be mistaken with a diffuse HCC. Hepatic fat deposition appears dark on CT. So because of that, it may be heterogeneous, geographical, may be mistaken sometimes. Hepatic microabscesses if occurring in a cirrhotic background, intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma, or diffuse metastasis giving rise to pseudocirrhosis. So let us just see a few of the examples. A case of confluent hepatic fibrosis. The signal changes are almost same as diffuse HCC. It is bright on T2, slightly hypointense on T1. There is mild diffusion hyperintensity. And it can even show some arterial phase enhancement, but then there is no washout. It shows persistent enhancement, and the key to diagnose is the capsular retraction. So when we see this kind of appearance, it is in favor of confluent fibrosis rather than diffuse HCC. Pseudocirrhosis may occur because of studied liver parenchymal metastasis. So it causes capsular retraction at different places, and it is very difficult to distinguish from a diffuse HCC. Tumor in vein is another category which is not very easy to map on images. The classical appearance is unequivocal enhancing soft tissue in vein regardless of visualization of parenchymal mass. So tumor in vein may or may not be associated with a parenchymal mass. If this appearance is seen, it's well and good. If not, then we have to take help of some additional clues which may suggest but may not confidently give a diagnosis of tumor in vein. These additional clues include occluded vein with ill-defined balls, occluded vein with restricted diffusion, occluded or obscured vein in contiguity with the malignant parenchymal mass, and a heterogeneous vein enhancement which is not attributed to artifact. So sometimes we may not see the arterial phase enhancement as such, but even if it is showing heterogeneous enhancement, it is suspicious for tumor in vein. Also, when we are differentiating a neoplastic from non-neoplastic intravenous soft tissue, then ADC values are of help. They are lower in tumor than non-tumoral thrombus. And also the susceptibility values are higher in tumor. So again, the same principle of imaging applies to tumor in vein, which we're applying to diffuse HCC. They are also not as conspicuous as other kind of HCCs. So in these images, it is very difficult to see the mass and also the tumor in vein. On the arterial phase, we can see some heterogeneous enhancement, which is again merging with the remaining liver parenchyma. However, if we correlate the images with MR, it is much more conspicuous, and we should try to include doing one MR as well whenever we have a case of tumor in vein. If we are lucky enough, we get these kind of very nice images even in post-contrast phases. We can see expanded vein with enhancing soft tissue. There may be multiple arteries within the expanded venous lumen. Sometimes tumor in vein may be quite aggressive. Like in this particular case, there was a diffuse HCC in the left lobe of liver. There was tumor in left hepatic vein, which went into the IVC, and through that it went into the right atrium. So it is not uncommon to see these kind of advanced tumor in vein also. This particular case was treated very well with SBRT and ablation therapy. Now, tumor in vein, although most commonly seen with HCC, but it is not synonymous with HCC. It may also be seen with intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma, combined hepatocholangiocarcinoma, or with some of the metastasis. There may be some pitfalls in the imaging. One should not forget to see the plain T1. So sometimes in plain T1 images, there may be a bright signal because of subacute blood degradation products. So if we just see this arterial phase, we will get a idea that there is arterial phase enhancement in this part of tumor. However, it was bright even on pre-contrast images. And then subsequently, if we follow this on the venous phases, we can see that there is no enhancement on the subsequent venous phase. There is absolutely dark thrombus. So this was a non-tumoral thrombus, which was looking like a tumor in vein if we overlook the pre-contrast table. Sometimes the tumor in vein may show minimal enhancements paralleling the parenchymal component. So in those cases, it may be more difficult to see, and there is slight clarity with MR images. Even the contrast enhancement is more conspicuous with MR than with CT. Sometimes a benign tumor, thrombus in the portal vein may cause luminal expansion. There may be aneurysmal luminal dilatation. So one should always be cautious to see the enhancement of the intravenous soft tissue component, not just the expansion of the lumen. Now we have almost covered the HCCs. Let us come to non-HCC liver malignancies. One of the most common is intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma. Now the enhancement pattern of this tumor is quite different compared to HCC. In the although in practice there may be a lot of overlaps as well. Both of the tumors may occur in a cirrhotic background. Sometimes the enhancement features are not that typical in HCC or with intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma. There may be a mixture of both the tumors. So classically in intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma, the enhancement in arterial phase is more at the rim. And on the venous phases, the washout is more at the periphery with concentric filling of contrast in the later phases. There may not be any washout, and if there is a washout, it is more at the periphery. There is IHVR dilatation distal to tumor in many cases, although even HCCs may cause IHVR dilatation sometimes, but this is more classically seen with intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma. And associated capsular retraction because of desmoplastic reaction associated with these tumors. So this is an example, a classical example of intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma. We can see that this is also showing arterial phase enhancement. We can notice lack of any cirrhotic features. So when cirrhosis is not there, it can be anything. So there is arterial phase enhancement more in the periphery, gradually filling up, and there is no significant washout, few tiny relatively hypo-enhancing areas which are necrotic areas, and there is a significant IHVR dilatation. Now this tumor is central in location, so we can't really assess the capsular traction in this particular case, but all these features, disproportionate IHVR dilatation compared to the size of tumor, a rim-like arterial phase enhancement without any washout, rather progressive filling in, suggests a diagnosis of cholangiocarcinoma rather than HCC. Now, this is another classical case of intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma. We can see a large lobulated mass, which is central in location. This is relatively brighter on T2 compared to routine HCC. HCC may or may not be bright, but intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma are usually bright on T2. On diffusion, they show strong diffusion restriction. Liver metastasis may be hypovascular or hypervascular. Hypovascular are best imaged in the portal venous phase or the hepatic venous phase. Hypervascular are best imaged in the arterial phase. There may be calcifications in the liver metastasis. And FDG PET CT is better than a routine CCT for liver metastasis. However, for detecting subcentimetric liver metastasis, the MR images are even better than FDG PET CT. So this is a classical example of liver metastasis. We can see large confluent mass in the right lobe of liver, few discrete masses. And these are very well mapped on the FDG PET image. In cases of hypervascular liver metastasis, like in this case, there was a primary neuroendocrine tumor in the pelvic cavity. We can see appreciate the strong arterial phase enhancement. And there was this metastatic deposits in the liver parenchyma seen only in the arterial phase with isodense signal on the subsequent venous phase. So with these metastases, arterial phase images are very important. So now we have compared majority of the liver tumors. Just to wake you all up, I have just included few of the cases as quiz. You can just mark yourself because it is difficult to interact with the audience on a Zoom meeting. So these are the images in case one. I'll explain the images for you and then you can make up your mind what it is. We can see these T2-weighted images. You can identify T2-weighted images even with the shade of the liver. The liver is quite dark and the fluid is also bright. There is bright fat. So it is a T2-weighted image. The tumor is markedly hyperintense on T2-weighted image. These are the in and opposed phase T1-weighted images. You can identify the opposed phase because of this India ink effect. And you can see that the liver parenchyma is non-cirrhotic, but there is a strong signal drop on opposed phase. The vessels are standing out against the parenchyma. However, the mass does not have any significant signal drop. And these are the post-contrast images. The pre-contrast T1, the arterial phase. We should always assess the enhancement, the arterial phase enhancement in a late arterial phase. This is a late arterial phase. You can even appreciate one of the portal radical taking up contrast. Early arterial phase gives us fallacious impression of non-arterial phase enhancement. So it's a late arterial phase. And then this is a venous phase. We can see some washout and there's a capsule. So we just discussed the imaging features of liver tumors. You can make up your mind, but I will tell this was a case of hepatocellular carcinoma occurring in a non-cirrhotic liver background. And there is gross liver steatosis in the background. So when these HCCs occur in a non-cirrhotic background, a lot of time they show strong T2 hyperintense, T1 hyperintense signal and diffusion restriction. And sometimes it is in a small tumor, it may be very difficult to differentiate it from a hepatic adenoma. But in this particular case, it was huge and it was showing washout, capsule enhancement. So it was HCC, not adenoma. Another case, again, we don't see cirrhosis in the liver parenchyma. These are the T2-weighted images. The tumor is bright on T2-weighted images compared to the parenchyma. You can see these tiny bright structures. We know that fluid is bright. So tiny bright structures which are upstream to the tumor are actually dilated biliary radicals. There is diffusion restriction. On T1-weighted images, also these bright structures, which are tortuous, tubular, are showing hyperintensity. This may be because of hemorrhage or proteinaceous fluid. Now coming to the post-contrast images, this is the early arterial phase. We can see slight rim enhancement. And this is the late arterial phase in which we can see enhancement, which is more at the periphery. And gradually the enhancement is progressing towards the center. There is no definite washout. So this is a case of cholangiocarcinoma. And on the coronal images, we can also see the tumor extending along the dilated and invaded biliary channel towards the hilum of the liver. So this was a case of intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma. Now, this case is a bit unique. We'll just see how. So this is again a non-cirrhotic liver. Cirrhosis makes the life more simple. So this is non-cirrhotic liver. We can see a large lobulated mass occupying almost entire left lobe. There's a slight biliary prominence in the lateral segment of left lobe. And on the post-contrast arterial phase, there is enhancement, which is more in the periphery of the lesion. In the subsequent phase, there is enhancement, again, more at the periphery. And then this enhancement is sort of filling the lesion. T2-weighted images show very bright signal of the tumor. You can see this line, which is because of the perfusion abnormality, a strong diffusion restriction. In an opposed phase images, again, there is signal drop in the parenchyma. In this in phase, you can see the vessels are standing against the parenchyma, while in opposed phase, they are blurred because the parenchyma is also darker like vessels. So there is a fatty liver background. On the MR post-contrast images, we can appreciate the enhancement in the periphery of the lesion, and then which is gradually increasing, progressing towards the center. There is a large necrotic area and you can see some washout in the periphery. If we compare this periphery from the initial part, there's some washout. So this kind of peripheral washout is a classical pattern of cholangiocarcinoma. So this particular tumor has few features of HCC and few features of cholangiocarcinoma. So this was a biphenotypic primary liver carcinoma. This is a combination of hepatocellular carcinoma and cholangiocarcinoma. There are few features which favor intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma like lobulated shape, indistinct margins, peripheral rim enhancement in the arterial phase, and presence of bile duct dilatation. And there are features which favor HCC, round shape or partially indistinct margins, heterogeneous enhancement in the arterial phase, washout pattern, and presence of tortuous tubulosis. So it is important to give a suspicion of biphenotypic tumors when they are found, because the prognosis changes and accordingly the treatment modality may also be changed. So after discussing the imaging features of all these liver tumors, let us just touch upon some of the treatment options and the relevant imaging. So once we have diagnosed liver tumor, we have to see what is the extent of tumor, what is the vascular anatomy, and what is the hepatic reserve. And keeping all these points into consideration, we select the best therapeutic approach for the patient. The ideal approach is surgery if it is possible. If not possible, then the patient can be offered ablation, catheter embolization, or radiation treatment. So surgery gives the best overall survival. It may be resection or transplant. The non-surgical options in ablation, the common options are RFA, microwave ablation, and ethanol injection. These are also done with a curative intent, and they are suitable alternative to surgical resection whenever it is selected properly. The catheter-based techniques include TACE, which is a transarterial chemoembolization using doxorubicin, adriamycin, mitomycin C, may be done with beads or without beads. Radioembolization can be done using yttrium 90 particles, and the bland embolization is usually not successful, so usually it is not practiced often. So these catheter-based techniques are used to downstage the tumors before surgery or as a bridge to transplantation. The stereotactic body radiation therapy or conformal RT can be offered to patients who have undetectable disease or hard to ablate hepatic malignancies, or in patients with relatively less reserve. If these are not possible, then patient is advised to undergo chemotherapy or systemic therapy using sorafenib. So NCCN has also outlined the treatment options to the patients, taking into consideration the clinical presentation and the surgical assessment. So one can go through these NCCN guidelines. So grossly, what we need to see on imaging for adequate treatment planning, we need to see the size and the number of tumors. If there is a limited tumor burden, which is defined as solitary HCC less than 5 cm or less than 3 HCCs of less than 3 cm size, then the patient can be offered surgery or ablation. In cases of larger HCC, the ablation is usually not very successful, and then surgical resection is the treatment of choice. When there is cirrhosis and multifocal HCC, or if there is a complex vascular anatomy because of which the surgical resection is not possible, then liver transplantation can be offered if there is no contraindication for transplantation. Or if the patient is not suitable for surgery, then catheter-based embolization or radiation therapy can be offered. In liver-only metastasis from colorectal cancer, surgical resection or ablation can be offered if there is a limited tumor burden, or IGRT can be offered as an alternative in patients with medical comorbidities. Also, during imaging, it is very important to note the location of the tumor. The tumor location is very important for planning the surgery, which kind of surgery, preserving which vessels and sacrificing which vessels. Also, it is important for ablative procedures. Relationship to surrounding organs is very important to predict their injury and, if possible, to take some preventive steps. Proximity to liver hilum increases the risk of biliary injury, and proximity to vessels limits the efficacy of thermal ablation. So in those cases, because of heat sink effect, the ablation is not very successful, and microwave ablation is preferred to RFA. Even for catheter-based techniques, we need to see the target hepatic artery selection for embolization. And if there is a biliary involvement, that it increases the risk for infectious complications and biliary necrosis. So that has to be taken into consideration. And when the patient is undergoing a targeted radiation therapy, then also relationship to adjacent normal structures is very important to document to avoid radiation injury. Also, imaging helps to estimate the functional liver reserve, FLR. Adequate liver reserve is very essential to prevent metabolic failure after liver resection. And also, if we are doing tear, then even a part of normal hepatic parenchyma is affected by the radioembolization. So we need to have a good hepatic reserve for that. Also, imaging gives a quantification of steatosis and cirrhosis. So those features are also have to be taken into consideration to determine the liver reserve. Now, once we have successfully treated the lesion, we need to do post-treatment imaging evaluation to assess the tumor response, to look for any complication, and also to look for any residual or recurrent disease. So the timings of these follow-ups may vary according to the different institutions. The standard timings are 1, 3, 6, 9, and 12 months after treatment, after which they can vary according to the presence of disease. We expect some common post-treatment changes in ablation cavity. There may be T1 hyperintensity, T2 hypointensity. After lipidol injection, there may be intense take-up of lipidol by the tumor if there is a successful treatment. There may be thin, smooth rim of enhancement surrounding a non-enhancing cavity. However, if we see a nodular, thick, or mass-like area of arterial phase enhancement, may or may not be accompanied with a washout, it indicates a HCC recurrence. And in cases of liver metastases, which are not hypervascular, we may see a nodular or halo pattern of enhancement or gross enlargement of lesions in the portal venous phases. So, because enhancement is very important in tumor response assessment, so the response criteria laid down by EASL and MRESIS criteria, they have both taken into consideration the size of enhanced areas, and accordingly, the response is categorized. So wherever we are measuring the tumor in a post-treatment setup, we need to measure the enhancing area, not including the non-enhancing component in between. So we should not be taking the entire largest dimension. We should just take the dimension of enhanced area. And if there are multiple discrete enhanced areas, then we need to add their diameters. So just to see one classical example, this was a case in whom liver ablation was done for this tumor. And in the follow-up scan, we could see this T2 hyperintense nodule at the anterior margin, which is also showing diffusion restriction. On ADC, there is no significant dark signal. It is just showing almost similar signal to the liver parenchyma. On post-contrast, this is a pre-contrast T1, early arterial phase, late arterial phase, we can see some heterogeneous kind of enhancement. And then this is the delayed phase. So a suspicion of tumor recurrence was given in this case because of this nodular pattern of enhancement and associated diffusion restriction in a nodular pattern with T2 hyperintensity. And the patient was suggested additional treatment. However, he was lost to follow-up, only came after 3 months with this large mass. So now we can see that this is showing strong diffusion hyperintensity and even dark signal on ADC map. On post-contrast images also, there is a significant enhancement in the late arterial phase with washout and a capsular kind of enhancement. So this is a case of classical recurrent HCC. So in these kind of cases, diffusion-weighted MR images are very helpful because there is a lot of complex signal in the ablated cavity also. There is a combination of coagulative necrosis, fluid necrosis, hemorrhage. So a lot of complex signal intensities. So diffusion images are especially helpful. While seeing these post-treatment scans, one should also be careful to look for these kind of seedlings on the surface of the liver or sometimes in the ablation tract. Whenever the lesion was hypoenhancing, even in pre-treatment, in post-treatment recurrence also, it remains relatively hypoenhancing, but still we can see some heterogeneous enhancement. There is gross increase in size in this recurrent tumor post-RT. However, the increase in size post-RT is not always a tumor. We are well aware that sometimes the necrotic lesion greatly increases in size post-RT, and especially after post-radioembolization. Sometimes the area of necrosis increases in size. So one should always take into consideration the presence or absence of enhancement. Like in this case, this was a normal post-treatment area. Or residual disease in very early post-treatment phases, rather advise a patient for follow-up and also correlate with other parameters like AFP, etc. And then on follow-up images, there may be resolution of this combination of factors taken into consideration parameters. Increase in size does not always mean increase in tumor. Like in this case, a large necrotic area has increased in the post-treatment evaluation. So we need to do this kind of necrotic necrosis quantification, which can be done by volumetric method also. We can exactly tell the tumor volume, the enhanced tumor volume, which has actually reduced in this case, and necrotic tumor volume has increased. A pitfall in post-radiation treatment of liver tumors is radiation-induced liver injury. We know that radiation causes occlusion of small veins in the irradiated area. So because of this, there is stagnation of contrast, and we can spuriously see some enhancement in the post-contrast images. However, if we see the diffusion images, there is no significant diffusion restriction. So we should always correlate the enhancement with other sequences as well. In fact, diffusion-weighted images are a very valuable technique for prognosis as well as for monitoring radiation therapy. And if we see ADC change of more than 25% increase, then it is identified as a predictor of favorable in-field control after a post-radiation treatment. So having discussed all this, we can say that imaging is crucial for successful management of hepatobiliary tumors with use of novel targeted therapies. And multi-parametric MR, including diffusion images, should be used more often for liver RT planning and follow-up. Future directions include quantitative and functional imaging, advanced post-processing techniques such as image fusion and volumetric assessment, and a formal imaging education in radiation oncology training programs. So thank you all for patient hearing and for giving your precious time for this activity.
Thank you, Dr. Kuti. Dr. Arun, are you here?
Yeah, please. Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Ruchi, for a very informative lecture on liver and hepatobiliary radiology. And I also would like to thank Dr. Anu Tiwari, President UP Chapter ARI, for arranging such a weekly seminar. Now we move towards the question and answer session. And the first question is asked by Dr. Awasthi, can multi-phase imaging be used for delineation of functional liver? Dr. Ruchi?
Functional liver, it may be helpful for delineation of functional liver as well. In fact, the multi-phase imaging, if you're talking about MRI, for functional liver volume estimation, we need to do multi-phase imaging because in multiphase imaging, we need to delineate the vessels and then accordingly, we need to calculate the volume. And also, there are a lot of advanced imaging modalities like T1 perfusion, which are very helpful for telling us the functional liver reserve. These are relatively advanced modalities. And the perfusion of liver is a very good marker of the liver reserve. So, yes, it is very helpful.
So I think it can be done, but it is challenging. You feel any difference in functional liver versus rest liver?
Yes, sir. Liver parenchyma may have multiple infiltrative pathologies, like there may be steatosis, cirrhosis, or iron deposition. So whatever volume of liver we are seeing may not be the actual working liver. So okay. In those cases, definitely the functional modalities give us a wealth of information.
Okay. And another question, which modality is better to detect a small lesion, whether MRI, CT scan, PET CT?
For very small lesions, subcentimetric lesions, diffusion weighted MR is the best modality.
Okay. So, but with advent of multi-detector CT scan, I have read their CT scan is more sensitive for to detect a small lesion.
No, sir.
Especially less than 1 centimeter lesion, 2 mm, 3 mm lesion.
No, sir. I don't agree with that. The small lesions less than a centimeter in size are much better seen on MRI than CT. CT just takes into consideration the contrast pattern. The contrast pattern of lesion may or may not be adequate enough to show the lesion on post-contrast images. But on MRI, we have multiple kind of image contrast. We have T2, we have diffusion, we have T1. So it is much easier to see tiny lesions on MR than on CT.
Okay. Is you using that liver-specific contrast?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We do all our liver MRs with multi-hands.
Okay. Are you using the same gadolinium in contrast?
Sir, it's a gadolinium-based contrast, but the carrier molecule is different. It's a BOPTA contrast, gadolinium-BOPTA. Okay. In the routine okay. gadolinium, it is DTPA, gadolinium DTPA. In this, there is BOPTA.
Okay. So then you charge extra for that or
So the commercial charges are almost the same. It is not much difference.
It is not much difference. Okay. Okay.
And, Dr. Ruchi.
Yes.
Yeah.
Ruchi, I need to ask one question.
Yeah please.
What is your preferred diagnostic image for cholangiocarcinoma specifically? And what should we use for delineation like CT or MRI in cholangiocarcinoma?
So if you are planning for surgery, for vascular assessment, for arterial delineation, especially segment 4 artery, all the branches of the artery, there's nothing better than contrast CT. CT angiography gives the best vascular delineation. But if we need to characterize the tumor per se, or if we need to differentiate the tumor between cholangiocarcinoma versus hepatocellular carcinoma, or if we need to see the infiltration of tumor in the biliary ductal epithelium, then MR is better than CT. So we need to, usually we have some background imaging done already when the patient comes to our hospital. So according to the treatment plan, if we are going to take the patient for hepatectomy, we need to do a CT angiogram. But if we are still doubtful about the etiology, then we may do a MR cast.
Dr. Ruchi? Dr. Madhu?
Ji. Yeah, Dr. Madhu, please ask.
Normally, it has been said that diagnosis of HCC is made by radiologist, usually by imaging.
Right.
And you act as a pathologist also in this scenario. But in which situations you suggest or you're not sure that we should go for biopsy?
Right. So as we discussed, there is a Lyrides classification system. And this was proposed only because there is a lot of overlap. In many situations, the lesions are crystal clear. They may be either benign or malignant. But in few situations, especially in cases of diffuse HCC, it may be very difficult to say that this is actually a tumor or non-tumoral. So in those cases, we have to do a biopsy, FNAC, or short interval follow-up. Now, this is again a very difficult issue because in cirrhotic livers, it is very difficult to do biopsies and there is a lot of risk of bleeding. So that is one of the reasons that sometimes there is a lack of acceptance of Lyrides by the surgical colleagues because they want a clear-cut answer. You tell us whether we need to operate or not to operate. So if we go according to the Lyrides in LR3 lesions, we need to do some FNAC or biopsy. Only in LR5, we are very confident, or in most of the cases of LR4, we are confident enough. But in LR3 kind of lesions, there are still about 30% cases of malignancy in LR3. So this has to be individualized according to the patient, whether we can do biopsy. If we can do, it is very good. But if we cannot do, and already suppose transplant is planned, the patient is anyway going for transplantation, then we can just prognosticate the patient accordingly that there is a suspicious area, it may come out to be positive on the explanted specimen, and then accordingly we can manage the case.
Good morning, ma'am. Kanu here.
Yeah, Dr. Kanu, please.
Congratulating for the nice presentation. I have 2-3 questions. Can I ask?
Sure.
Yeah, please.
So, the one question is mostly we do the stereotactic radiotherapy for the liver. We need a breath holding when we are going for the PI-based technique. So, how we should ask the radiologist or we request the radiologist about the breath holding technique and everything and about the HCC.